There's no way you could love him, I could love him. He had to love us first. It wasn't even in us to love him. But thank God for his grace. While you're standing, Father, we thank you tonight and we praise you. We glorify your name, most excellent God. We thank you, O God, for you're the God of our salvation. You're our Redeemer. You're our Savior. You're our King. We pray, O God, during this revival, that it will continue and won't stop. Oh God, that our hearts will forever be seeking after thee, following after you, God, that we might know you even the more. You're a God of power, resurrection. Oh God, even when we suffer and go through, God, you're there. Oh God, and our strength is made perfect in weakness. God, we thank you tonight. And we pray, oh God, that your word will come forth with the power, the Holy Ghost, and demonstration, that our hearts will so be pricked that in every one of us will say, Lord, what shall we do? Oh God, we thank you tonight for godly sorrow that worketh repentance. We bind every spirit of self-sufficiency and arrogance that would deny that we need you tonight. Oh God, we come to you and we cry out, I need thee, oh, I need thee. God, we need you tonight. Oh God, some are coming from different walks and some are coming, oh God, facing one situation and another. Oh God, but we can all agree that we need you tonight. Oh God, rain down upon us. Send forth thine anointing. Destroy every yoke in the name of Jesus. Oh God, whatever sins we've committed, God, we ask you tonight that you would cleanse us from all unrighteousness, that you would blot out all iniquity, that you would pardon our transgression. Oh God, that you would send your word and heal. Oh God, send your word and heal tonight. Heal us of our backsliding. Heal us from every destructive way in the name of Jesus. Oh God, we appeal to your mercy tonight and we declare your goodness. Let Israel now say that the Lord is good and his mercy endures forever. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Come on, give God praise tonight. Hallelujah. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We are so grateful for another opportunity to be in God's house. Amen. And to be in revival. Amen. It's good to be revived. Amen. It's good to refocus. Amen. Our attention back to God and seek God's face, because he said, if you return unto me, I'll return unto you, which means that there are places and times in our lives when we turn away from God. Amen. And we can all testify to those times when we turned away from God, the tragedy and the devastation that took place in our lives until we had to run back to God and say, God, I need you. Amen. And we just thank God. I'm excited that he doesn't stand there saying, I told you so. And he just receives us with his grace and his love. And I'm so grateful for him on tonight. And thank God for our pastor. Amen. Elder Michael Turner Smith. Amen. Come on, we thank God. God put this in his heart. Amen. We thank God for a man of God that can hear God. And not only hear him, but obey him. Amen. I thank God for your obedience tonight. And I thank God for our First Lady. Amen. The blessing that she is. Amen. Mighty woman of God and prayer. Amen. We thank God for her. It's little things that First Lady does. I needed to go see my niece a few weeks ago, and I needed to go before visiting hours. And my niece said, well, you can come if you have something to show your clergy. And I kept thinking, I got that old card from House of God, and it was like 2000, I think. And then I remembered, I said, First Lady made us cards. Amen. And I said, there she goes. Amen. So I thank God for that, those little things, the thoughtfulness, and I thank God for Elder Harris tonight. And that mighty man of God. And his wife. And I thank God for my own husband tonight. Deacon Embry and Assistant Pastor Embry. All those titles being prayer. Amen. And to Minister Carr tonight. Deacon Carr. All of you prayer warriors. Amen. All of you that make up the household of faith. Thank God for my mother tonight. Cindy, thank God, and Shell. We went to church together. Amen. We all went to St. John. Amen. Together, and I'm so glad to see you. Amen. And to your daughter, Sierra. Amen. God bless you. Amen. Are you coming tomorrow? Praise God. Let the Lord touch your heart. Amen. We would love to have you come back tomorrow. And we thank God for all of you, the mothers. Mother Bennett, God bless you. And Mother Telma, we just love you. And we thank God for you. Amen. We ready for the word tonight? Amen. Amen. Come on, let's go to Ezekiel chapter 36. Ezekiel chapter 36. When you have it, say amen. Ezekiel chapter 36. When you have it, say amen.
Amen.
I'm asking you to do me a favor. If you can stand, if you would stand with us as we read the word of the Lord. Ezekiel 36. We'll start with verse 24. For I will take you from among the heathen and gather you out of all countries and will bring you into your own land. Then will I sprinkle clean water upon you, and ye shall be clean from all your filthiness, and from all your idols will I cleanse you. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh, and I will put my spirit, there he goes again, I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and ye shall keep my judgments and do them, and ye shall dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers, and ye shall be my people, and I will be your God. I will also save you from all your uncleannesses, and I will call for the corn and will increase it and lay no famine upon you. And I will multiply the fruit of the tree and the increase of the field, that ye shall receive no more reproach of famine among the heathen. Then shall ye remember your own evil ways and your doings that were not good, and shall loathe yourselves in your own sight for your iniquities and for your abominations. Not for your sakes do I this, saith the Lord God. Be it known unto you, be ashamed and confounded for your own ways, O house of Israel. Thus saith the Lord God, in the day that I shall have cleansed you from all your iniquities, I will also cause you to dwell in the cities, and the waste shall be builded, and the desolate land shall be tilled, whereas it lay desolate in the sight of all that pass by. And they shall say, this land that was desolate is become like the Garden of Eden, and the waste and desolate and ruined cities are become fenced and are inhabited. Then the heathen that are left round about you shall know that I, the Lord, build the ruined places and plant that was desolate. I, the Lord, have spoken it, and I will do it. Thus saith the Lord God, I will yet for this be inquired of by the house of Israel, to do it for them. I will increase them with men like a flock, as the holy flock, as the flock of Jerusalem in her solemn feast, so shall the waste cities be filled with flocks of men, and they shall know that I am the Lord. While you're standing, one more scripture, Titus chapter 3. Titus chapter 3, verses 3 through 8. For we ourselves also were sometimes foolish, disobedient, deceived, serving divers lusts and pleasures, living in malice and envy, hateful and hating one another. But after that, the kindness and love of God, our Savior, toward man appeared, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost, which he shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ, our Savior, that being justified by his grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. This is a faithful saying, and these things I will that thou affirm constantly, that they which have believed in God might be careful to maintain good works. These things are good and profitable unto men. Amen. You may be seated. Amen. We will, by the grace of God, continue to minister the benefit of having the Holy Ghost. And as a subtopic there, new life. New life. The prophet speaking on behalf of God utters the words inspired by the Holy Ghost, revealing to us the heart of God. The heart of God towards us and towards mankind. The man, the state of man in corruption, fallen, not God's original purpose for man. We see in the beginning, God. Everything started with God. The great I am that I am, the self-existent one, Jehovah God. Everything started with him. We know that because of corruption and sin and Satan falling to the earth, and there was a state of chaos, but God did not create that chaos. Something so wonderful that God created the universe. The Bible says only a fool has said in his heart that there is no God. We look at a watch and we see there must be a watchmaker, right? We see a building and we know there must be a builder. We see creation and we must know that there is a creator. So we came from God. And to see the state of man as described by Ezekiel, obviously something transpired between the time that God said, let us make man in our image and in our likeness. Breathe into us the breath of life. Man became a living soul. So wonderful. Everything God looked at, he said it was good. And he created an environment for us to live in. And then complications. I like to call them complications. Because the way of the Lord is simple. Listen real close. The way of the Lord is simple. You couldn't get any better than what man had. He had a home. He had dominion. He had authority. He had a relationship with God. Which one of us heard God's voice walking in the cool of the day? I mean, I'm just trying to paint a picture. That's the kind of relationship in the atmosphere. Don't forget that word. The atmosphere that man dwelt in. And here comes the enemy to complicate the simplicity of God. It was simple. Don't eat it. That's it. It was very simple. Don't need it. And here comes the enemy to make things difficult. Did God really say that? Complicating things. Did God really say that? And as I was studying and meditating on the word, the Lord just showed me complication brings distance.
Yes.
Complication brings distance. The more he created, the enemy created an element of doubt. Eve began to move away from a foundation of truth. It was very simple, but became complicated. And I thought about it because the enemy uses the same tactic.
Yes.
I hear so many saints say, I can't read the word. It's too complicated. I don't understand. It's too complicated. But that's the trick of the enemy. The word of the Lord is simple. But here he comes. Because if it's complicated to you, then distance between you and God will be created.
That's right.
And as long as you confess that you don't understand the word and it's complicated, you won't.
That's right.
And you won't be able to draw nearer to the Lord because God draws us with his word.
Yes.
Now faith comes by hearing, and hearing by what? The word of God.
Go ahead.
We're even cleansed through the word.
That's right.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes, thank you, Father. Hallelujah.
We are created in his image.
Yes.
And in his likeness.
Yes.
So, Ezekiel, God is saying, I'm going to cleanse you. I'm going to wash you. I'm going to clean you from all your filthiness and from all your idols will I cleanse you. When we talk about the fall of man, I thought about this too. You know, sometimes we say things, the fall of man, right? The fall of man. Where did he fall from? Where did he fall from? He was standing on the earth. But he fell. Where did he fall from? Man had a position, a place of authority. Stay with me because I got to lay a foundation. So when God said to Adam, where art thou? He wasn't just asking for his physical location. When he said, where art thou? I believe God looked down and saw that the place of authority that Adam once held, Satan was sitting there.
Wow.
So God looks and said, that's not Adam.
That's right. Right
now. Wow.
Adam, where art thou?
Wow. Yes. Go ahead.
Yes.
Wow.
He doesn't belong there. That was your place.
Yes.
What happened? The woman was deceived.
Yes.
Tricked. Yes. Through disobedience, doubt. And man fell from his place of authority. Distance, yet again. Complicated yet again. Something so simple now becomes so complicated. So he fell from his place of authority. So what happens? How does man get to this place where there are now idols that are worshipped instead of God? How does man get to this place where he needs a heart transplant? How does man get to this place where he once enjoyed sweet fellowship and communion with God? to a place where he needs to be made over. A new heart.
Yes.
A new spirit.
Yes.
Because the physical impact of that spiritual fall was resulted in death, pain, suffering, sorrow. That wasn't God's original intent. But here man is taking on a fallen nature. We're going to go to Ephesians 2. A fallen nature. Now his heart is hardened. Trying to find himself. Trying to find purpose and intent. But you can only find that in the one that created you. Fallen from a place of God consciousness to a place of self-consciousness. Think about it. He had a consciousness of God, but as soon as he fell, the godliness and the nature of God lifted off of him, and he saw himself. He looked to himself and became self-conscious and said, I'm naked. And God had to say, who told you that? You were made in my image and my likeness. What image have you taken on now? I want to show you this. So distance is created. Man is cast out of the garden. We'll go back to Ezekiel. I just want you to see this. Man is cast out of the garden. But I'm so glad that before he was cast out, God prophesied to him. It's not always going to be like this. It's not always going to be like this. This is the hope. This is the gospel. This is the hope. That although man fell from one place, God exalted him to another.
Amen.
Verse 1, and you have he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air. I want you to see this in scripture. As you're listening, saying, what is the evangelist talking about? Man fell and God looked down and saw Satan sitting in his seat. But you know what? The throne of God is not up for grabs.
Amen. Amen.
I thought about it. I said, I thank God for that.
Yeah.
John said, I saw one sitting on the throne. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
He tried.
Yes.
He tried when he tempted Jesus in the wilderness. But what did Jesus say? It is written.
Amen.
Amen. You need the word. Tell your neighbor, you need the word of God.
That's right.
So we know that man fell and sin and death was introduced. Verse 2, where in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air.
Wow.
You see, that's where he is now.
That's right.
That's Satan's position now.
Yes.
Adam had that authority.
Yes.
The spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience.
Right.
I thought about that. I said, you know what? Man still has dominion.
Yes.
You can still tell a dog what to do.
Yeah. That's right.
And they'll do it.
Yeah.
You can still take a wild stallion and break his spirit.
Yeah.
Dominion.
Yes.
But we had to be restored authority through Christ Jesus.
Yes. Yes.
And it couldn't just be the same level of authority that we had before. It had to be higher.
Amen.
And whom also in Christ both which are, where is my, there we go, I'm sorry. Where in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. That's the spirit that's now working in man.
That's right.
Among whom also we all.
Yes.
Did you see that?
Yes, ma'am.
All of us had our conversation in time past in the lust of our flesh,
right,
fulfilling the desires of the flesh,
that's
and
right,
of the mind,
right,
and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others.
That's right.
But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, have quickened us together with Christ. By grace ye are saved. This is where I want you to see verse 6. And have raised us up together and made us what?
Sit
together. Where? In heavenly places. Where?
In
Christ Jesus. So he falls, but he is restored in Christ. And God prophesies, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. And it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. The Savior promise. Prophesy. That's hope. That's hope. Let's go back to Ezekiel. So he says, I'll put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes. When sin came, sin was new for man. Man didn't know what sin looked like, although he was now a partaker. So the law was given so that we would know what sin looked like. God is reestablishing a connection and a relationship with man. And he's saying, if you're going to have a relationship with me, I need to give you some guidelines, and I need you to see what sin looks like. So he says, I'm the Lord thy God. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Don't make any graven image, any likeness of anything that's in the heavens above, that's in the waters under the earth, none of that. For I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God. Don't bow down to any other god. Don't serve them. Don't take my name in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Honor your mother, your father. Don't steal, don't kill, don't commit adultery, don't covet, don't bear false witness against your neighbor. Paul said, I didn't know sin until the law.
That's right.
I didn't know sin until the law.
That's right.
So in Galatians we see that the law was given for a period of time until faith would come. Let me back up for a minute. I'm trying to lay this foundation. So this is where verse 27, he says, and I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes. Without the Spirit of God, there is no way that we can keep God's commandments.
That's right.
Amen.
That's right.
Amen.
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 Paul speaks and says, if there was a law that could have given life,
That's right.
Then there would have been no need
for
Jesus.
That's right.
But here we have the law as a schoolmaster, a guide to preserve us, to keep us long enough until faith would come. But no power to keep it. So God is telling us this is what godliness looks like, because man lost that.
That's right.
And even today, every man does what's right in his own eyes.
That's right.
Some religions don't even acknowledge sin.
That's right.
But when man fell, there was a law that was introduced called the law of sin and death.
All
The wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. I'm trying to make this as simple as I can. I said, you know what? This is just one big love story.
Amen.
Trying to simplify it. It's just one big love story. A wonderful Savior, a wonderful God made a creation, made a man in his image and his likeness, breathed into him the breath of life. He became a living soul. He begins to walk on the earth. He begins to take dominion and produce and multiply and replenish and join fellowship with God. And an enemy comes in, a jealous enemy, a rejected enemy comes in, doesn't like the harmony, doesn't like the relationship, wants what the man has, authority. Wants to come in and create distance, wants to complicate things. That's what jealousy does. God, having created man with a will, a free will, that's why God wants you to love him freely. It's not a something that is forced. We ought to be able to look up and see God's creation and realize that the breath that's in your body, you didn't create it, and recognize that you came into this world without your own purpose. Yes. You couldn't even control when you came into the world.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
My God.
Yes.
And just be grateful. Yes. Every day you wake up to be grateful. And here man is enjoying fellowship and communion with God.
Yes.
And the enemy comes in and breaks it up. So here the God, it's just like a mother and a child, distance, being separated, disciplined. I'm a God of my word. I can't allow you to stay here. Right? If you can't abide by my rules, isn't that what we say? You can't stay here. You got to get out. We call that tough love,
right?
Tough love. But I still love you. I still love you. And this separation is not going to be forever. Because I'm not going to allow the enemy to steal my creation. I made you for my glory. I made you for my purpose. Not his. So rest assured, I will get you back. Isn't that a love story?
Yes.
I will get you back. Even if I have to come down myself, I will get you back. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Yes. Yes.
He that knew no sin became sin for us. That's a love story. What man would lay down his life for a friend? What God would leave his place in eternity? A holy God wrap himself up in flesh. Subject himself to a death on a cross. That's a love story.
Yes, yes, yes.
It's not hard.
No, it's simple.
It's not hard. But oh, how he groaned and travailed, waiting for the fullness of time.
Yes, yes, yes.
And he couldn't keep it to himself, so he would speak to the prophets every now and then and tell them, I will heal their backsliding. I want you to tell them that I'm married to them.
Yes.
I want you to tell them that right now I know they have my commandments, but they don't have any power to keep it. Just hold on till faith comes.
Yes.
Just hold on till grace comes.
Yes.
And when grace comes, when Jesus comes, I'm going to take that stony heart out of you, and I'm going to put my spirit in you, and that which you were not Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
I know you lost. I know you're confused.
Yes.
I made you for worship.
Yes.
You're looking for love. You came from love.
Right.
So anything that looks like it couldn't possibly give you love, you will attach itself to you. Even if that thing ends up hating you. Even if that thing ends up abusing you. Even if that thing ends up neglecting you. Yes. You'll keep chasing, looking for love. Because
Wow.
you're lost.
Yes.
Hallelujah. But I will put my spirit within you. I'm not just going to put it in an old wineskin. I'm not going to take my holiness and put it on unholiness. My God. You must be born again. Thank you, God. Look at this and we'll move on in a minute. But I want you to see the nature of God. This is so powerful. Because when God restores, he always gives back more than what you lost.
That's right. Amen.
So it wasn't enough. See, it wouldn't be restoration if man was just restored to the place that he once had.
That's right.
He had to go to a higher place.
All right. Come on.
Even with Jesus giving us life, he didn't just give us life. He gave us life more abundantly.
All right.
That's the kind of God that we serve.
Yes.
We see that with Job. When God took everything that Job had, he wouldn't be the God that he is if he just restored to him what he lost.
That's right. Oh,
come on.
Glory to God. Hallelujah.
He had to give him back double of what he lost.
Yes.
That's why I love God so much. I love God so much. Because even when the enemy think he's stealing something, restitution has to be made.
All right.
I'm just trying to help you understand this terminology. Verse 29 in Ezekiel 36, he says, "And I will also save you from all your uncleannesses." And when I save you from your uncleannesses, this is a part of revival. And you look for this. A part of revival is restoration, a restoring of something that was lost. And when God restores it, again, he doesn't just give you back what you lost. He restores double. He restores triple. I want you to see these words. "And I will call for the corn and do what? Increases."
Amen.
The enemy comes to kill, steal, destroy. But Jesus said, "I come that you might have life and that more abundantly."
Yes.
So although man fell, when Jesus came, he brought salvation.
Yes.
And salvation is life eternal.
Yes.
Salvation is life beyond this life.
Yes.
That's the understanding that we have. That's why we can rejoice. Any man that believes on him has eternal life.
Yes.
Not just when you die. You have it right now.
Amen.
And with that salvation, because people all the time say, "I'm saved." What does salvation mean? What are you saved from? What are you saved for? I'm saved for his glory.
Yes.
When salvation comes of a joy, when salvation comes of peace, when salvation comes an adoption.
Yes.
Help me, Holy Ghost. So you are not living until you receive Jesus.
Yes.
That's the picture that I'm trying to paint.
Yes.
You are not living. We just read it. You are dead in your trespasses and sins.
Yes.
But here's a picture that God is painting through Ezekiel. When I save you, your messed up, your unclean self, your confused self, your broken self, your lying self, your deceiving self, your adulterating self.
Yes.
When I cleanse you, spirit. When everybody is in a famine, you'll be in abundance. When everybody is lost, you'll have a sense of strength.
Yes. Yes. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to the holy name. God, glory. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy
Spirit. I will call for the corn.
Yes.
And increase it.
Yes.
And lay no famine upon you.
Hallelujah.
Look at that. And I will multiply the fruit of the tree. Do you see that? You should just write somewhere, restoration.
Yes.
And I will multiply the fruit of the tree and the increase of the field, that ye shall receive no more reproach of famine among the heathen. You see, when you are in Christ Jesus, there's no more curse.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
When you are in Christ Jesus, there's no more curse. Everything that God is speaking here is the opposite of what happened from the curse.
Amen.
He said, now, whereas before the earth would yield her abundance, you're going to have to work the earth by the sweat of your brow. It's going to bring forth thorns and thistles, which you're seeing as a reversal of the curse.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Oh, y'all should be excited about that. Everything. This is good.
Yes, it is.
When you serve God, though you might have trial, you have peace.
That's right.
Yes.
When you serve God, even when you go through difficult situations, you always come out victorious.
Yes. 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 Yes.
Thank you, God.
But when you turn your back on God, you can go through the same situation that you went through when you were serving God, but it's harder. So there is a victory that comes in Christ Jesus. There's a victory that comes in serving God. While we are in the world, we are not of the world. But when you turn your back on God, things get hard. They get hard. They get difficult. What is it called for? We're not going to be much longer. What is it called for? When this gospel is preached and you hear about such a loving God and the sacrifice that he made, you begin to look at yourself and see your unworthiness.
Yes.
That's what the gospel. There's hope in it.
Yes.
But it makes us look at ourselves.
Yes.
He said, I want you, because this is a gift.
Yes,
what Ezekiel is talking about here is a gift. He said, you can't work for it.
Uh-huh.
It's my choice.
Yes.
God made a choice.
Amen.
To love us.
Amen.
I want you to hear that.
Amen.
Grace is about a choice.
Yes.
God made a choice to love us. That's why there is nothing that you can do to merit righteousness. Righteousness is imputed through faith. God made a choice, and because he made a choice, nothing can separate us from the love of God.
Amen.
Relish in that for a minute.
That's right.
Nothing can separate us from the love of God because he made a choice.
Thank
That's why his love is unconditional. Did you hear that? What did I say about the love of God? It's unconditional. But do we sin because his love is unconditional? No. God forbid. He says, then shall you remember your own evil ways and your doings that were not good, and shall loathe yourselves in your own sight for your iniquities and your abominations. As we go through this revival, I'm believing God, that's what our hearts will be pricked, and we will cry out to God that God will deliver us from all manner of laziness and sin and foolishness and pettiness, and that we will turn our hearts back to God, that we will be delivered from a cursed mindset and take on the mindset of God and the blessedness, that we're walking in victory, that we're walking in the blessings and the favor of God. We've been called for a purpose and for his glory. Everything that God does is great.
Yes.
Come on, let's turn to Titus real quick. I see your weariness. Let's close out with Titus. Sad, because Jeremiah, you can write this down, Jeremiah 9. Saying they don't even know me. I made them and they don't know me. What a sad love story. I made them, they don't recognize me, they don't know me. And this is where the work of the Holy Ghost comes in. Titus 3. For we ourselves also were sometimes foolish. Sometimes I look at people, they'll remain nameless. Very famous people. And I say, God, they doing this, they doing that, they doing that. And when I looked at the scripture, the Lord said, we were once foolish. Disobedient, deceived, serving divers lusts and pleasures, living in malice and envy. Some of us hateful now. Some of us hateful now, hating one another. But after that, thank God for the after that. The kindness and love of God, our Savior, toward man appeared. Thank God. Not by the works of righteousness which we have done. I think I'm the one saying that. It's about God. If you're here tonight, it's because God is drawing you closer to him. I said, if you're here tonight, it's because God is drawing you closer to him. We'll say more about that in a minute. Not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost comes to renew. Regenerate. That means to reform, for us to be reborn. That's why Jesus said, marvel not that I say unto you, ye must be born again. When you are not born again, your nature is ugly. The only thought that you can think is a wicked thought. Your imagination is only evil.
Amen.
You have no capacity for God. The washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. Talking about the benefit of the Holy Ghost. He renews. He reforms. We must be conformed to the image of Christ. We lost that. We lost that. But the Holy Ghost comes to restore. You know the definition of life? If something is alive, it has to have the capacity to grow.
That's right. Wow. That's right.
If something is alive, it has to have the capacity to grow.
That's right. Yeah. Yeah.
We were dead.
Yeah.
But the Holy Spirit comes and brings life.
Yeah.
And if you don't have the Spirit of God, you cannot grow. We need the Holy Ghost. We need the Spirit of God. He is the very nature of God, the life of God. When man was formed, God breathed into him the breath of life, and he became a living soul. When Jesus came, he came a life-giving spirit. The Spirit of God in us enables us to be like God.
Yes.
Enables us to grow.
Yes.
That's why Paul kept saying, grow in grace.
Yes.
And in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Yes.
That's why Paul can say, these are the fruits of the Spirit.
Yes.
There is no way that you are going to live a life of victory without the Holy Ghost.
Amen. Amen.
It won't happen.
Amen. It won't.
You will be in the same space or the same place spiritually the day you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior if you don't have the baptism of the Holy Ghost. You understand what I'm saying? That is the life of God. That is the Spirit of God that brings new life and causes us to be born again, causes the old nature to fall away. Even Paul said, any man that has been born again or any man that has received the Spirit of God and is led by the Spirit of God is no longer under the law.
That's right.
Amen.
That's right.
The law is for the lawless.
Yes.
The law is to remind us of sin. But when the Spirit of God comes into a man and he is born again and he is regenerated, his thoughts are not of a sinful nature.
Amen. Yes. Amen. 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 Preach.
Yes.
He doesn't have to be reminded of sin because the Spirit of God, the commandments of God are now written upon his heart.
Amen.
Oh, I pray you hear me today.
Yes.
Anybody that's saying salvation is hard, you're trying to do it in your flesh. Anybody that says serving God is hard, you're doing it in your flesh. Because in all actuality, you don't have to do anything but submit. Paul said, the life that I now live, I live it through Christ.
That's right. That's
right. That's the problem.
Yes.
We're trying to serve God through our own means and our own measures. We even make receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost hard. When he said he's a gift.
Amen.
Oh, that's for tomorrow, man.
Amen.
It's not hard. It's hard when you try to do it in
right.
yourself.
Amen.
But it's not hard when God does it in you. You cannot live holy with the old man.
Amen.
It's not possible. It's not possible. You cannot grow without the Holy Ghost. You can't grow without the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Verse 6. Which he shed on us what? Abundantly. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. our Savior. Did you hear God tonight?
Yes.
He loves you.
Yes.
That's the first thing.
Yes.
Somebody say better.
Better.
I mean better, better, better. If we had to fall, thank God for the better. Thank God.
Yes, thank you, Lord Jesus.
For the better.
Yes.
If you didn't know it, you know tonight that He loves you.
Yes.
If you didn't know it before, you were saying, am I always going to have to live with this? Some of us got things in our lives that torment us. And we live with it. I remember not long ago I had a pain. And I'm trying to get comfortable with the pain. Fixing pillows and... And the Lord... Thank God for the Holy Ghost.
Yes, yes, yes.
Said, why are you trying to get comfortable with that pain?
Wow.
Tell that pain to leave your body.
That's right. That's right. That's right.
And I rebuked that pain and said, with your stripes, Jesus, I am healed.
Yes.
And I'm telling you, my arm was able to lift, and rotate.
Thank you, Father.
That's what the Holy Ghost will do.
Yes, that's right.
You don't have to live with that.
No, you don't.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
You don't have to live with fear.
That's right. Amen. Amen.
You don't have to live with hurt and anger and bitterness and confusion. You don't have to live with that. He came that we might have life.
Yes.
And that more abundantly. I thought about this and we got tomorrow night and we have Sabbath. But I thought about that. That's why faith is so important. Because Elder made a statement a few weeks ago, if your faith is not producing, is not real faith.
That's right. That's right.
Because life has the ability to reproduce.
That's right.
And life has the ability to grow.
Yes.
And when we have faith in God, now faith is
That's right.
the substance of things hoped for. It is the evidence of things not seen. When we have faith, when we have the Holy Spirit, we can look at a situation and not see it the way that it is, but see it the way God sees it.
All right.
That's why Jesus could look at a blind man and say, open your eyes.
Yes.
Because when he sees that I do what I see my Father do, he can look at the blind man and know the ability to open up his eyes and pronounce it in the earth and say, make spittle or do whatever, and his eyes would be open.
That's right. That's right.
Amen.
He's given us that same anointing.
Yes.
He's given us that same power. He's given us that same authority. But as believers, we're trying to live like the old man when we have been born again and called out of darkness into his marvelous light.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Come on, stand to your feet, because I just... I just hear God saying that give us. That seed of God is in us. So powerful. But we're still focused on the old man. And we're still focused on that old man's limitations. And we keep saying things like, I can't help it. And we keep saying things like, I'm afraid. We keep saying things like, God will do that for them, but he won't do it for me. God is no respecter of persons. And God is calling us to a place of power. Moving from a place of unbelief to a place of power. Because when Jesus rose, he said, all power in heaven and earth is in my hands. And though we lost that place of authority, we regained it through Christ Jesus. He said, hitherto have you asked nothing in my name. Ask. And ye shall receive. Ask and it shall be given. Just like that. And he said, ask for the Holy Ghost.
Ask for the Holy Ghost. Glory. Hallelujah. Bless your holy name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Anybody here on word tonight?
Hallelujah.
God is coming to restore.
Yes. Hallelujah, Father. Thank you. Hallelujah.
Stuff that you accepted. That stuff is going to have to get out.
Yes.
It's going to have to leave. Because you know what? Many of us are living with things we shouldn't be living with.
That's right. Yes.
I'll say amen to that.
Amen.
Anybody living with something you don't want to live with?
Yes.
Even the guilt of your past. As far as the east is from the west, he said, I'll remove it.
Yes.
You can't even be used of God because you keep telling God that he shouldn't use you because of what you used to do, of who you used to be, and because of your struggles that you have right now. See, that's not a God mindset. That's a man mindset.
That's right.
See, I do something to you, you'll remember it 20 years
that's
from now.
That's right. That's right. That's right.
Say amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. It's the truth.
Right?
Yes.
But God says he will not remember anymore.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God wants to free you. God wants to free us and bring us to a place, I mean, operating under the anointing of God, filled with the Spirit of God, living victoriously. I mean, God has come to revive us. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, God.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Come on, revive me, Lord. Take away my stony heart. Give me a heart of flesh. Put your spirit in me, God. I want to be born again. Take away the negative mind. Give me your thoughts.
Yes, God.
Thoughts of the righteous.
Yes, Lord.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you, God.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Elder Smith is coming. Amen. Anybody want to give their life to the Lord?
Yes.
Anybody want to rededicate their life to the Lord tonight? Yeah, Lord, I've fallen. I need to come back to you.
Yes, Lord.
I need to return to you.
Yes, Lord.
Because I know there's more.
Yes.
Have you ever said that? I know that there has to be more.
Yes.
There has to be more to life than this.
Yes.
I complicated things. You complicated things. But God comes to simplify.
Yes.
He comes to cleanse.
Yes.
He comes to renew.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus. Anybody tonight?
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Lord, make me over.
Yes.
Lord, make me over. Create in me a clean heart. Renew the right spirit within me, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you, God.
Tonight to stream with us, we want to take the time to say thank you. And many options that you have, we thank the Lord for choosing to stream with us and join us via streaming live on tonight. Amen. There's a word of the Lord for you too. Amen.
Amen.
Pray that you receive it on tonight. You can make it on tomorrow night. We'll be here tomorrow at 8 o'clock. We'll be here on Saturday as well. Praise the Lord. Service starts at 11. So if you're anywhere within the vicinity, come to 5116 Righteous Town Road. Trust, Pastor, you will hear a word from
Amen.
The Lord. Amen.
Amen.
We invite you to do this as well, too. If you'd like to make a generous donation, we'll say that it's because of people like you who make those donations
yes.
and enable us to stay on the air. You can go to our church website, www.nbhop.org, and you'll find a place there to be able to make a donation. Pray about it. Be sensitive to the Holy Spirit. We want to tell you in advance, we appreciate what you do for us. Amen. Our best English as we close out on tonight. You ain't seen nothing yet. The best is yet to come.